How's everybody doing out there? All right, good to hear. Good to hear. Are we ready to praise the Lord? Are we here to praise the Lord? Are we here to hear what he has in store for us? All right, let's stand. Everyone, please stand. Righteousness. We sing out hallelujah. We sing of your great name, Jesus. We sing out hallelujah. We sing of your great fame, Jesus. We will sing forever, we will sing forever, hallelujah, our King has come. We will sing forever, we will sing forever, hallelujah, our King has come. We sing out hallelujah, we sing out great name, Jesus, Jesus. We will sing forever, we will sing forever, hallelujah, our King has come. We will sing forever, we will sing forever.
Thank you so much for being here. Just never quite sure when that song's going to end, Brother Sean. Tried to move like four times and it kept going. But it was good. Praise the Lord. Let's pray this evening. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you in Jesus' name. Thank you so much for this night, for this opportunity to worship again. And Lord, as we were just praying earlier with the ministry leaders, pray for next door. If there's a young person over there that needs Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, that tonight would be the night. They give their life to them. Or maybe in this room, or maybe in discipleship, Lord. We just never know. And I pray for your will and way in all of these areas, Lord. I pray that you would move during this offering, take it and use it for your honor, for your glory, and to further your name. And bless the remainder of the service. In Jesus' name, amen.
Protect me from what I can't see, Lord, I believe. Amen. Well, that is true. Praise the Lord. It's like we said this morning, we have seen the Lord answer some prayers and see people walk in from really bad illnesses and surgeries, and the Lord's hand just touch them. He is still working miracles, and it's awesome to witness. Me and Brother Ricky were talking about it before service, and I mentioned it here recently. I don't know why it's amazing still, and it's not, I mean, I don't know that I want to ever lose the amazement, but he was talking about how he was teaching in Sunday school about something that was very relative to what I was preaching this morning, and it's just, it's amazing how the Lord does that. And, you know, here's one of the things that, to me, is so awesome, is sometimes it feels like whenever God does that, maybe he's talking right to you, and, you know, you're like, oh, man, God's trying to get my attention, but there may be 50 other people just like that. It just, it shows just how much the Lord cares for each one of us, whether he's convicting us or encouraging us with something, and so it's just an amazing thing to have that relationship with the Lord. If you have your Bibles, if you'll turn them over to Psalm chapter 101, and we're going to look at what the Lord has here. You know, this is, I think, a true statement for most of us. Some people are self-defeatist, and they are always on themselves about something, and so they see their own faults more than anything else. But I think, for the most part, it's easier for most of us to see others' faults before we see our own faults. I think that's the truth. If we're honest, it's easier to point out someone else's flaws or someone else's, you know, mistakes or something like that versus recognizing when we're in the wrong or recognizing when we've made a mistake. And so I think that's a pretty general truth. Usually easier to blame others for something versus taking responsibility ourselves. Again, whether it be our attitudes, our actions, our speeches, here's the example. You say, well, I wouldn't do this if they wouldn't do that. You know, so like we kind of say it's their fault. And sometimes, you know, we're provoked to things. But I believe to be an effective follower of Christ, and even this, a leader, which it has to, we have to understand something. We all are leading in a sense as far as being ambassadors for the kingdom of God. But someone has to make sure that they're doing everything within their power, especially if you are given a measure of influence, or if we want to say power, to be who we're supposed to be. I shared this a couple weeks ago, but the driver that we had going to the airport, I was sharing the gospel with him and asked him about a relationship with the Lord, and he began to share that he didn't have a relationship with God, and one of the reasons why he didn't know if he wanted to pursue it, basically, was that he knew people who called themselves Christians or that talked about God a lot, that were religious, whatever. But he said a lot of those people don't really essentially live the way that they should be living while they profess, you know, to have this relationship with God. And he gave us one example of a friend that he knew was always talking to him about God and trying to kind of push God off on him. And one day he said he walked into a casino and saw that friend gambling and drinking. And he said, you know, I thought, you know, that doesn't match up. You're trying to tell me about God, and yet you're doing these things. And the truth is this, you know, we can't control each other's actions. We can't control another person's actions, can't control their attitude, can't even control what they say. But we can control our own attitude, actions, and the things that we say. And so this evening, we're going to look at this psalm, I think a psalm that David penned, being determined to be and to do what was pleasing to God within David's power. David's going to make some declarations, and he's going to basically say, I'm going to do this, and I'm not going to do that, in the sphere of influence that God had given him. Of course, we know that he was the king of Israel. And so within that sphere, David is saying, I realize God has entrusted me with this, and so I'm determining not to do these things, and I'm determining to do these things. And that's another thing, too. God, as I said, has given us all a sphere of influence, whether it's at home, if you're a mother, if you're a father, if you are a grandparent and have influence, whether it's our neighbors. And I want to say this, our neighbors are being influenced by us, whether we think they are or not. Amen. That's the truth. They're watching us. They see what we do, when we do it, how we do it. They're watching our faithfulness to the Lord and all those things. Whether it's a sphere of influence in a Sunday school class, or influence over coworkers, or maybe you're a boss and you have employees, or just influencing other church members. We all have some sort of sphere of influence that we have. And so we're going to look at what David declares and see how that applies to us. So let's pray and we'll get into it. Father, thank you for this time. Thank you for allowing us again to meet here tonight. Thank you for the opportunity to worship you in song. And Lord, we thank you for the precious gift of prayer. We thank you that we can call on your name and bring others before your throne and pray for each other. And I pray that we would never leave that gift just sitting idly by. I pray that we would lift each other up daily, that we would call on your name, and whether we intercede or whether we are just praying for you to bless each other, Lord, I ask that we would, again, be faithful in that. Lord, help us tonight to take your word and apply it where we need it. And, Lord, maybe it's to help us down the road, or maybe it's to speak to us right now where we're at. But I just pray that we would be open to your word and allow the Spirit to move in our presence this evening. Lord, just work now, and we'll praise you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, Psalm 100, verse 1. I will sing of the mercy and judgment. Unto thee, O Lord, will I sing. Now, here we go. Brother Jeffrey got on this a couple weeks ago, and so I'm going to get on it tonight. Music. Some people think it's not a big deal what kind of music they listen to. Some people don't think it's a big deal what kind of music they sing. But I want to say this. If we hope to be any influence for the kingdom of God, then you and I must be, as fleshly people, prone to fleshly actions and thoughts and attitudes, we've got to be influenced by as many godly things as possible. That's the truth. If we don't think that it's going to affect us in some form or fashion, then we are just absolutely fooling ourselves. Here's the reason why. The world is influencing us for hours on end, day after day after day. It's everywhere. Everywhere we turn, the world is influencing us to worldliness, to fleshly things, to even sinful things. The enemy's trying to use all these things to keep us from being the light in this world. And so if we don't think that these things affect us, then we're fooling ourselves. I believe when we can, we should choose to be influenced by godly things. Let me say that again. I believe that when we can, we should choose to be influenced by godly things. For instance, if you're going to listen to music, is there anything wrong with certain kinds of music? I'm going to say this. I'm going to reiterate what I preached for years and Brother Jeffrey reiterated a while ago. There's no example in Scripture. Matter of fact, what was music created for? What was music created for? To praise God. That's what it was created for. What were our lives created for? To walk with and to worship God. And so when we have the choice, why would we not be influenced by godly things? Why would we not want to say, you know what? I have the option right now to listen to something that's going to please my flesh or something that's going to influence the Spirit, something that's going to give strength to and aid the spirit, the spiritual man that, as Paul said in Romans chapter 7, delights after the law of God, that wants to do the things that are pleasing in God's sight, but has this war with his flesh. The members that know what sin is and know how to do the things in the world and know how to experience the pleasure of sin. Again, when we have the option of saying, I'm going to be influenced by this or that, why, knowing the battle that we all have, if we're going to be honest, we all have a battle in the flesh every single day. Amen. Why would we not choose to be influenced when we could by godly things? We'll see more of this in a minute, but it's exactly what Christ taught. When he said it's out of the abundance of the heart that words come. What you put in comes out. Jesus teaching in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 6, he said this in verse 22, the light of the body is the eye. If therefore thine eye be single, thy whole body shall be full of light. But if thy eye be evil, if your eye is bad, thy whole body shall be full of darkness. If therefore the light that's in thee be darkness, how great is that darkness? Again, that was in the section of teaching where we're saying, lay not up for yourself treasures upon the earth where moth and rust doth corrupt, but lay up for yourself treasures in heaven where moth and rust doth corrupt. And he began to talk about how the Pharisees, they were living for greed. They were motivated by selfish and fleshly and worldly things. They were being influenced by those things, and it was darkening their spiritual eyes. They couldn't, because it was all evil in them. That's what was influencing them. Again, the truth is this. I've shared this example many times before. I don't know that there's any adults in here, maybe there are, that don't know how to tie your shoe. Most of us, I believe, know how to tie our shoes. And the reason why we know how to tie our shoes is because at some point in time, probably when we were all little kids, our parents, our grandparents, a friend, or we spent hours on end practicing, doing something, being influenced. And so today, we can tie our shoe without even thinking about, okay, make a loop, go around the tree, or whatever we don't have to consciously make that thought because it's ingrained in our heads. It's something that we can do, I mean, subconsciously. Just reach down there and tie your shoe, you're done. At some point in time, we were influenced to that point to where now it's not even something that we have to make a concentrated effort to think about. We just do it. That's the way our brain works. That's the way our being works. When we are constantly inundated with something, that's just the way it is. Let me give you another example. There's nowhere in Scripture that we know the Bible talks about casual dating. But what is the culture in America today? Casual dating. Scripture gives us a formula for marriage. It doesn't give us a formula for dating. It gives us a formula for marriage. And so when we look at the state of our world today, or our culture today here in America, and again, around the world for the most part, we see this culture that casual dating's okay. Why? Because it's constantly inundated. It's what the world says, what everybody around us is doing. It's okay. It's what otherworldly music is about. It's all out there. And so we become desensitized. And we don't get focused on what God's Word says. We start living by what we've been influenced with. And the same exact thing about the music that we listen to, the stuff we watch. It just becomes an influence on our life, and we're fooling ourselves to say it doesn't. And let's just say it didn't really affect us that much. If it meant the difference between hearing songs that glorify our Lord and Savior who gave himself for us, or that are about something meaningless or whatever, why would we not choose songs that glorify our Lord and Savior? Again, it just goes down to that matter of heart. We could maybe pick at things and say, well, is it sinful or is it not sinful? What would be better? That would be the question. What would be more beneficial to us? Again, when we look at this option of being influenced, why would we not choose that? And again, if we're going to be an example, or if we're going to accomplish anything great for the kingdom of God, to be effective in the different spheres of influence that we have, again, be it our home, be it a Sunday school class, be it a job, be it a ministry, if we're going to see effective change or things be done great for the kingdom of God, then we must make conscious choices to have mercy and judgment, just as David said, come out of our mouths. Our praise needs to be continually to the Lord. And for that to happen, that's got to go in. That's got to go in. From out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. Verse 2, it says, I will behave myself wisely in a perfect way. Oh, when wilt thou come unto me? I will walk within my house with a perfect heart. Now, this is an awesome scripture. I love this. It's challenging, but it's also encouraging. He was determining to live a blameless life. Now, we know that David didn't live a sinless life. We know that David had his mistakes. David had his failures, his faults. David had his struggles. David was a man. And so we know that about David. But what David was displaying here and writing out here was this determination to live a blameless life. His heart was determined to live that blameless life before the Lord. He wasn't saying, look at me, I'm living a perfect life. Look at me, I'm living a sinless life. He wasn't saying that. He was saying, I am determining to live in a wise and perfect way. I'm going to walk within my house with a perfect heart. Now notice that again. I will walk within my house with a perfect heart, with an integral heart. This is very important. Integrity is revealed at home. And it begins at home. Anybody can appear to be integral in a church setting, but it's revealed at home, and it begins at home. We need to be who we are and what we are everywhere we are. It's not just when I'm around so-and-so or around these people or in this setting. We need to be who we are and what we are everywhere we are. Just like we saw this morning, our speech with truth and grace and gentleness, guess what? It needs to begin at home. The way that we talk to our loved ones, you know, I've shared this before and even talked about it in marriage seminars that we've had before. What is that problem? What is the deal that we can be driving to church and be like, walk in the church and be like, hey, brother, how you doing? Hey, sister, let's go in the room and pray. Let's go over here and talk about the Lord. Let's sing to the Lord. I wasn't talking about the people going in the room to pray. I'm not pointing y'all out. I don't ride to church with y'all, so I don't know. But our lives at home don't need to look different than the lives that we display at church, or the lives that we display at our jobs, or the lives that we display anywhere. Our lives at home need to look like our lives everywhere. So we, like David, need to have the same determination that we're going to walk in an upright way, even and especially, I would say, at home. That's how we need to determine in our lives, just like he did. And so again, if we have grandkids or if we have kids in the house that we have influence on, impact, please listen to this. That impact could be and is an eternal impact one way or the other. And I promise you this. We don't want it to be the other. It's sad and unfortunate, but I've seen so many kids, so many teens or whatever, experience something at home quite different than what they experience at church. And they turn away from the Lord as soon as they can because there's a lack of realness in a relationship with Christ at home. And so they see that this isn't really real across the board. It's just something you put on at church. And so for them, it's not personal. It's not real. And again, please don't mistake. I'm not talking about sinlessness. Because every single one of us, parent or grandparent alike, we're not without fault. We're talking about a sincere, passionate pursuit of being a godly Christ follower everywhere. This is what we want to be. This is who we are. This is what we're striving to be. I'm not pretending to be sinless. I'm not pretending to be perfect, but I'm striving after Christ, and it's revealed at home. It's revealed in the store. It's revealed at church. That's just who I am. I don't have to pretend here or pretend there. It's just the way it is. But he goes on in verse 3 and continues to make these declarations. He said, I will set no wicked thing before mine eyes. I hate the work of them that turn aside. It shall not cleave to me. And maybe one of the more difficult growing challenges that face us today is this right here. With wickedness on every corner and just about every screen that's out there, or potentially every screen, maybe it's not on every screen, but potentially on every screen. I think that today in 2017, we face a much more inundated challenge in this area, I believe. I'm not saying that David didn't have an issue. Obviously, he had an issue. Obviously, he had a struggle in some areas when he allowed certain things to be before his eyes. He faced this issue both in his weakness, but also, I believe, in his just observing of wickedness in general, others living that out. And here he's making a choice in this declaration. I'm not going to put this before me. I'm not going to be influenced by wicked things or wicked people. I'm not going to allow the lifestyle of the wicked to influence my life, because I'm trying to live a life that's pleasing to my God. And so here he is making a choice to reject the filth that can flood the eyes. That's what he said. I'm making a declaration not to set anything wicked before my eyes. That's what I'm determining to do. I'm not going to associate with people who are living in wickedness. I'm not going to be influenced by that lifestyle. I'm not going to set anything, choose to put something before my eyes. And so for us, a choice we all need to be very adamant on making, and here it is, daily. A choice daily is to do the same exact thing David's saying here, because the truth is this, that wickedness can invade us in a 60-second commercial. You're watching maybe a normal show, and then something wicked comes on a commercial. And if we're not adamant to be on guard, we may not think, well, it's really not a big deal for me. What about those little ones that are in the next room hearing it? Maybe not seeing it, but hearing it. Maybe they do see it. We've got to stay on guard. We're supposed to be living lives as vessels, instruments of righteousness and vessels of honor unto the Lord. That's what we're supposed to be doing. And so you can see the heart of David in this disdain for wicked things being influencing what he sees. And not only that, for those who are used by the enemy who turn aside and turn others to the side. He despises them. But listen, if you're going to try to influence for wicked, and you're going to try to influence other people for wicked, I don't want to have anything to do with you, is essentially what he's saying. I want to remember, just as I said last week, Jesus said these words in Luke chapter 11, verse 23, "He that is not with me is against me, and he that gathereth not with me scattereth." And so our fleshly actions, our slanderous words, even sometimes they may seem so innocent in our minds, we're just saying something about that Sunday school teacher. We're just saying something about that brother or sister. We're just saying something about that pastor. We're just saying something about that deacon. It's not a big deal. We're just it's just the truth, though. The slanderous words, injurious words, and our damaging testimony can all be used by the enemy in perfect timing. In his perfect timing, to attempt to destroy the body of Christ and to affect the mission that we're supposed to be on this earth. See, if the enemy can keep the body of Christ divided from within, then he doesn't have to worry about the mission without. If he can keep, brother, this is what we were talking about this morning, having that speech that's full of truth, but grace and gentleness. Using speech that's good to the use of edifying. There's no need for us to speak things that would be cutting and tearing down of other believers or other people, period. And David, in expressing this disdain for those who fall away and affect others in this negative way, made a declaration here. It's not going to affect me. I'm not going to allow it to affect me. I'm not going to allow others turning aside or others slanderous words or I'm not going to be associated and therefore affected by them. And I believe this has got to be true for us. Listen, the only reason why slander, gossip, negative speech has any impact at all, here's the reason it does, is because it's given one of these. Because it's given ear. If every single child of God, every single member of the church, when someone began to say, "You know, brother so-and-so, they irritate..." Whoa, hey, brother, you should probably go talk to them. Just don't give it an ear. Just don't give it an ear. If we wouldn't give gossip and slander and all this negative speech an ear, it would be stopped. And if we encourage each other to follow a biblical pattern, man, we would have, I believe, just such an amazingly growing, strong, unified relationship that the enemy couldn't penetrate. But as long as we give way to that, then we can be used by the enemy to make that happen. Again, we can't change other people. We can only choose what we do or choose what we don't do. But what other people do cannot, we must not allow it to change our devotion to Christ. We must not allow it to change our love for Him and our love for the body. See, I believe when we stay connected to the Lord and we stay walking in the Spirit of God, when we go that way, that we can do this. But the moment we start handling adversity, the moment we start handling the different attacks that come at us, the moment that we start handling, well, where's so-and-so? Why are they upset? Why are they going? The moment we start doing that and handling it in our own flesh is the moment we start to be affected in a negative way. It's amazing. It's amazing the moment we start doing this, how the enemy starts to open doors. Even in relationships, these relationships that draw us further away from where we should be. I've said it before, it's amazing how this happens. The moment that you get upset about something, I don't like how the music director talked to me. It's amazing how you can find somebody else who didn't like the music director that talked the way they talked to them as well. It's amazing whenever the pastor upsets you, that you find someone else. Maybe get in line. I mean, hey, I'm not bragging in that, but maybe the truth. It's amazing how that works. Whenever you become bitter or upset about something, how you find someone else who is bitter, miraculously, about the same thing. But I believe it's a matter of choice, a matter of the heart. That's why David declared in the next verse, "A forward heart shall depart from me. I will not know a wicked person." I'm not going to join myself with someone who has set themselves aside, who set themselves apart, who's determined to live a wicked life. I'm not going to do that. I'm determined to maintain a right heart and to keep myself separate from evil influences. That's what I'm determined to do. I'm determining to keep my heart right with the Lord and His people. And many of you know this, but it's amazing also what happens when you're around people that edify and lift up, that pour out righteous things versus wicked things. It's amazing what that does to your spirit, what that does to your person. When you're around people that are uplifting, you're like, man, I like being around them. They're encouraging. It's better to be around them. Now, not necessarily when you're in a bad place or when your flesh is struggling. Then it always feels better in the flesh to be around people who sympathize with you or feel the same way. But also realize this, many people and maybe some in here work in environments where you are surrounded by wickedness. Your coworkers, all they do is curse and talk about vile things and so you're in an environment all the time where you're surrounded by that. And I will say this to you, your home, your private time with the Lord, and your interaction in the house of God with the body of Christ should be a retreat for you. It should be something I cannot wait to get with the people of God, to be around people who love the Lord and are talking about godly things and we're singing about the Lord and to the Lord and we're hearing from His Word. It should be a retreat for you. You know what? It was for David. It was a retreat for David to have this intimacy with the Lord and to go to the house of God. That's why I said, I was happy when they said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. But the next verse, he points out something I believe very important as well. The truth about negative influences and those who can be entrusted to serve. And this is so vital. We've mentioned this before in other sermons, but look in verse 5. It says, "Whoso privily slandereth his neighbor, him will I cut off." Now remember, David was the king. David had this authority, he had this influence in the kingdom. And so he had the ability to say, you're not working here, you're working here. You're not serving in this area, you are serving in this area. He had that authority that God had given to him. And so he's saying this, He's identifying. There's a couple different groups of people. Those people who are going to slander their neighbors privately, he said, I'm going to cut those people off. Person that has a high look and a proud heart, will I not suffer? I'm not going to allow that. He goes on in verse 6 to say, but my eyes shall be upon the faithful of the land, that they may dwell with me. And he that walketh in a perfect way, an integral way, a sincere way, he shall serve me. So as the king, as the leader, as the person who had the say in the kingdom, he identified some things. There were some people that he could not trust. So this is the category of lack of trust people. These are people who are not going to be entrusted to serve in the king, in the kingdom, to serve the king in the kingdom. Here's the first little characteristic he said. Someone who would tear him or another person down in private. Someone that would tear or slander the king or some their neighbor down in private, they're not going to have an opportunity to serve. Number two was someone who is full of pride and someone who is full of arrogance. So these people, they have no place to serve. Someone who's a gossip, a slanderer, tearing other people down, and someone who is prideful and arrogant. They just have no place. There's an entrepreneur, some of you are familiar with him. His name is Dave Ramsey. And I shared a little bit of his quote a few years ago with our school staff. And I was talking about one of the things that he said in his company, and he said this. He said, I will say this, gossip will get you fired faster than anything else. Gossip. Talking about somebody else in the workplace, tearing them down to make yourself look better, or just to tear them down or what for whatever reason, will get you fired faster than anything else. See, here's the reason why. Because gossip or slander, tearing someone down, is a poison that sometimes has irreparable damages done. Sometimes when that's done, I've used the illustration before. I read it years and years and years ago. It's like if you can imagine a plane driving over a major city. Let's just say New York City. A plane that was full of feathers. And you drive over that city, and as you drive over that city, you just dump out that plane full of feathers and allow those feathers to go all over that city. That's similar to what gossip does. Because what happens is those feathers will end up floating. Some of them will catch a breeze and a wave, a jet stream or whatever, and take it to places you wouldn't even thought to take it or thought to look to see if they made it there. Some of them will make them down into creases and crevices in the city streets that you would never find even if you looked. And gossip is the same way. It makes it sometimes in the crevices and the places of people's lives and hearts and some people that you would have never thought it would have affected. And that's why it's so dangerous. That's why it's such a poison. That's why David said, you know what? Those people can't be trusted. Those people can't be entrusted to serve if that's the character that they have, is to tear somebody else down. They can't be trusted to serve. But in verse 6, he identified the person or the people that he could trust and that he would entrust to serve in the kingdom. Number one characteristic, notice this, someone who's faithful. Faithful. Faithfulness is such an essential characteristic for service. When an employer is looking to hire somebody, they want to know that the person they're paying to do a job is going to be there to do the job. That's what they want. They want to know, can I rely on this person to be here? Because I'm hiring them because this is the work, this is the service that has to be done. And so I need them, as I'm going to pay them, I need them to be here faithfully to perform their duty. Well, David said, you know what? This person that I can entrust to serve me in the kingdom has got to be, first of all, faithful. I've got to see they had demonstrate this characteristic of faithfulness. And then similar to that, he goes on and says someone basically who is trustworthy or integral, someone who's mature, is a perfect heart. Now, I'll say this, as a pastor, that's exactly who I'm praying for. And when we think about whether someone is looking to be a leader or to serve in a certain area, is this person absolutely faithful? No worries, no questions, are they going to be here? They're faithful. But beyond that, are they trustworthy? Have they shown to be trustworthy and integral and displayed maturity to handle adversity, to handle what may come? I believe that's what any leader looks for. But it's amazing when someone is simply faithful in all things, what that, number one, reveals, but also what that cultivates. When someone's faithful, what do you mean, what does it reveal and cultivate? I believe God does amazing and great things with those who are faithful. If you remember Jesus telling the story of the parable of the talents, what did he say to those servants that were faithful, that handled his talents rightly? He said, "Well done, thy good and faithful servant." Faithful. Because you are faithful with this, you're going to be entrusted with this. We're going to be faithful stewards. So what does it mean if someone's faithful, it sets the foundation for this? Well, I mean, what do you mean? It helps with that. See, someone who is faithful allows a foundation of trust to be set. Remember that second characteristic, trustworthiness? Faithfulness sets that foundation of trust. That foundation of trust is then built upon, and integrity can be seen, and maturity can be revealed through that. And that type of healthy relationship for any of us produces amazing fruit. But this is contrast as he goes on, as we get ready to close in verse 7 and 8. Look what he says. Here's the contrast. "He that worketh deceit shall not dwell within my house. He that telleth lies shall not tarry in my sight. I will early destroy all the wicked of the land, that I may cut off all wicked doers from the city of the Lord." Again, David was entrusted with this. David had this responsibility of leadership. And he said this, look, wickedness will never be blessed by God. Wickedness, evil doing, will never have God's hand of blessing on it. Some people say, yeah, but the Bible says that he causes it to rain on the just and the unjust. But listen, God's not rewarding wickedness when he causes it to rain on the just and the unjust. God doesn't reward wickedness. He will reward wickedness one day in the judgment, but he doesn't reward it with blessings. I believe if we're going to see the hand of God move and bless our homes individually, if we're going to see the hand of God move and bless our church, and here's even bigger than that, if we're going to see the hand of God move and bless our effort in this city, this area, for his kingdom, then we, like David, must determine with everything in us to live lives not pleasing to ourselves, but lives pleasing to the Lord. Lives not pleasing to the world or to others, but lives pleasing to the Lord. Again, to refuse wickedness, to refuse the wicked influence on our life, whenever we can, when we have the choice to say, I'm not going to allow this to influence me. But the sad truth is this. Sometimes we don't even try. Sometimes we don't even try to refuse the wicked influence. Sometimes we just willingly embrace it. Sometimes it's just because what we want to do. For instance, again, there's a lot of trash that we can watch on the TV, in movies, on the internet. There's a lot of trash out there. But there are also some great tools and resources that we can use to be wise in what we do and what we don't do. One of the things that we've used for years, and we've tried to tell anybody and everybody that we come across, or somebody starts asking us about a movie or saying something about a movie, is, and if you don't use this, I encourage you to write it down and use it every single time that you consider watching a movie, and it's plugged in online. They have an app. You can download an app, and you can use the app. We use it every single time that we consider watching a movie. But it's a Christian-based movie review application site that's very, very helpful. It basically is going to tell you what's in a movie before you pay your money, before you sit in your seat and begin to be influenced by what they are going to pour into your life. By what they are going to pour in, that's going to affect your eyes, that's going to affect your ears, that's going to obviously affect your heart. You can get on there and say, okay, this has this, this, and this. Is this going to be helpful, beneficial? Is this going to be worth paying and being affected like this? If it's got junk in it, then why would we grieve the Spirit of Almighty God that lives inside of us? By willingly saying, I know it's got this, but I really want to see it. I will say this. The entertainment isn't worth the grieving. The entertainment of our flesh is not worth the grieving in our spirit. It's quiet. A lot quieter than this morning. Just saying. But why would we damage right fellowship with our righteous God? Why would we do that? Why would we say, I have a choice? I have a choice to either get closer to God or to allow something to be driven, a wedge in between me and my closeness with God. Why would we make a choice when we could make a choice to avoid that? We could take measures to avoid that distance. Listen, again, we already have enough influence in our life to drive wedges between our relationship with God, right? I mean, that's the truth. I think if we're all honest, we could say, man, I'm so busy. It's hard to get that time alone with God. Some people try to do it on their drive to work. Some people do it at their lunch hour. Some people do it late at night or early in the morning to try to get that in, that time alone with God. We have so much going on in our life and so much influencing us. We don't need to add to that. We don't need to add to the gap that the world and the enemy is trying to cause between us and our Lord. We need to take every measure possible and do everything possible to draw nearer to God, to avoid that wicked influence in our life like David determined to do. Say, you know what, I want to be closer to God. So tonight I want to encourage you and challenge you. Just like I've been encouraged and challenged the same way. Let's be like David. Again, he wasn't sinless. He wasn't perfect. He had his own weaknesses and struggles and sins and failures. Yes, we know that about him. But we know this about David too. The Bible says that he was a man after God's own heart. That he had a heart for God. God used him. We saw when David failed and he fell and he made those mistakes. We saw his response to that. Psalm chapter 51, he was broken. He was sorrowful. He had godly contrition. He wasn't happy that he sinned against God. That's what he says in Psalm 51. Against thee and thee alone have I sinned. It hurt him to know that he hurt his God in his failure. So David wasn't okay with it. Again, he was a man like us, men and women, normal people. But he had a heart for God and he had determined, you know what? When it's within my power, if at all possible, I'm going to choose to be closer to the Lord, to refuse the wickedness, to live a life that's pleasing to my God. And I want to challenge you and encourage you with that. Again, if there's maybe no bridle or no filter or no steps of checks in what you listen to or what you watch, I really want to encourage you to do that. There's a lot of negative influence out there. And again, just think about that question. If it was a matter of getting closer to God or having more of a wedge driven, why wouldn't we choose to be closer to the Lord? Why wouldn't we take the steps necessary? And so I want to encourage you that. If our ushers will come at this time, I'm going to hand out these prayer sheets. And thank you, sir. As you get these sheets, you'll see a couple different things. We're going to, I kept, again, the pastor, the leaders, the church and community of Sutherland Springs on there. I want to continue to keep them in prayer, as I said last week or the week before. Also, if you'll look down there at the bottom under our church, I want to be praying now for a blessed and fruitful Christmas season. I shared this with our ministry leaders before service that sometimes people come to church twice a year, lost people, and one time typically would be Easter, and the other time is Christmas. But statistics have shown a lot of people go to Christmas Eve services. And so on our calendar, we've had this all year long, we have a Christmas Eve service on, of course, December 24th, which is a Sunday. And we're moving the service from 5:30 to 5, and it's going to be a candlelight service. And so what I've been praying for, and I ask you to be praying for in this service and leading up to that service, and to be praying very specifically, but that we would see that family member or that friend or that neighbor that maybe has been burdening our heart, that we've been praying for, that we've been witnessing to, that we've been inviting, that coworker, whatever, that they would come to faith this Christmas season. And I believe when we get specific with God, that's what He wants us to. He wants us to be real in a relationship with Him. And so I know for me, there's a couple that are very heavy on my heart, and I'm going to be inviting them hard to that 5 o'clock Christmas Eve service to get them to come here and hear what God did for them 2,000 years ago. And so I want to ask you to be praying and really be thinking about who that is. Again, maybe it's a family member, maybe it's a coworker, that neighbor, a friend, whatever, that they will come to that service and they will get saved. And so I really want to see the Lord move in that. So I want to be praying now, faithfully, week after week, for those things. So let's take about 5 or 10 minutes or so and pray through this list.